If you have your Bibles, will you stand to your feet? And I want to read to you a couple portions of Scripture. I'll be speaking basically out of John chapter number 6, and I want you to go there. And also, if you would, go to Luke chapter 22, Luke chapter number 22, and verses 47 through 49. If you're there, say amen. I'm glad I got a Bible that is inspired, yes. Infallible. Listen to me carefully. If you can't trust this Bible, you can't trust anything. Everything that I am and we are as a church is because of the Word of God. I know the scoffers, the atheists, the agnostics, they try to cast doubt on the Word of God. By the way, that's not a new thing. That's what happened in the Garden of Eden. Are you there? Let's look at these verses. I'm going to read just verse 70 and 71, then we'll use a lot of chapter 6. The Bible says that we're doing a character study. That's what we're doing in these hours. The Bible said, Jesus answered them, "Have not I chosen you 12? This is his 12 elite men. And one of you is a devil." He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. Now turn over with me to Luke chapter 22. If you're there, say amen. Amen. And go down to verse 47. And while he yet spake, behold, a multitude, and he that was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near unto Jesus to kiss him. But Jesus said unto him, Judas, betrayest thou the Son of Man with a kiss? And when they were about him, saw what would follow, they said unto him, shall we smite with a sword? Our Father, thank you for the good word of God. Help us as we preach on this subject this morning, that folks here, everybody here, before they leave this room, will be saved. Everybody here, that before they leave this room, they'll decide to serve God. Everybody here, before they leave this room, will decide the word of God is true and we must live by it. And we'll praise you and honor you in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen. I have been doing a character study. I've got about 18 or 19 biblical characters in the New Testament that I've been studying. And today we're going to be dealing with Judas Iscariot. A lot of preaching could be said today about Judas, and we're going to try to give you as much as we can over these next few minutes. I do know this, when he was born, just like you birthed your babies, you had him in, had your babies in your arms, and he was cuddled, he was loved on, he was blessed by his parents, just like you did. Yet, ain't no parents today calling their babies Judas. Come on, help me. The only thing gets called Judas anymore is a goat or a dog. That's the truth. See, this same Judas who was born was the same Judas that I read to you about in Luke 22 who took a group of men for 30 pieces of silver and they went into the Garden of Gethsemane where the Lord was praying. The town was asleep. His disciples was asleep. The Lord was praying there. And then he came in there and he betrayed Jesus with a kiss. What a hypocrite. Somebody help me preach right there. and he greeted him, and he kissed him. And here's what I want to preach on this morning. How many of y'all agree with me that Jesus is the doorway of the church? Yes. Raise it up. Yes. The doorway to heaven. Come on. Amen. He said, I am the door. Amen. You said, well, what did Judas do? Listen to the text. I want to preach on the man that kissed the door of heaven and went to hell. Chad, the man that kissed the door of heaven and went to hell. It's not enough to be close. It's not enough just to have a little bit of knowledge. It's not enough just to almost be a Christian. I want you to know this morning, I'm glad that I'm not an almost Christian, because I can take you back to January 31st, 1973, when the Holy Ghost came and convicted me of my sin, and the Word of God was revealed to me, and I trusted Christ as Savior.
Amen.
I'm going to give you four or five things this morning that I learned from Judas. First of all, I learned a lesson about salvation and the danger of being religious but lost. You know what grieves me? You know what really grieves me? Throughout America, though we're religious, but there's a whole bunch of people, all they got's religion and no salvation. Let me say four things about Judas and this lesson about salvation. Would you agree with me? He had the right association. He'd run around with the right people. He'd run around Peter, John, James. He was one of the 12. Yeah, he was with the cream of the crop. Can I tell you something? You can have the right relationships. You can be raised up in church even and die and go to hell. Are y'all with me? Number two, he had the right education. Boy, we got some of our kids getting ready to go to college, and I've already been praying for them. Thank God for education. Thank God for that. But I want you to know there ain't none of you in this room, including myself, has an education like Judas had. You say, well, who taught him? Jesus. He was there on the Sermon of the Mount. How many of you people been with me to Israel? Raise your hand. Remember the Sermon of the Mount? Judas was right there. How many remember going all the way up to northern Israel, up next to Lebanon and Syria, when I showed you that big rocky face and those idols, where those idols were placed. And Peter gave his confession upon this rock, I'll build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Judas was there. Listen to me, you can be educated up to here, but if you're not saved, you're going to fall and go into hell forever and ever and ever. Somebody help me. Look, I'm not done yet. He had the right reputation. Guess who the treasure was? Come on now. I'm going to ask the treasurer to stand up right now in the church, okay? Guess who the treasurer was? Judas. He must have had somewhat of a reputation for them to trust him with the bag. You could have the right relationship. You could have the right education. You could have the right reputation. But if you don't have Jesus, listen to me, if you don't have Jesus this morning, you're on your way to hell. Oh, I'm not done. I'm almost with this first thought. Not only did he have the right association, education, reputation, but he had the right participation. Oh, yeah. He's a member of the First Baptist of Jerusalem. He served God. But can I give you a verse of scripture? Many, many will say, Lord, Lord, have I cast out devils and done many mighty works? And he said, depart from me, I never knew you. You can participate in religious activity. You can have the right association and reputation and education and burn in hell forever and ever because you've been deceived. Lord, have mercy. But not only do I see, and I really want y'all to grab this next one. Not only do I see a lesson about salvation. By the way, salvation is through a person. Not through religion, not through baptism, not through sacraments, not being good, not your good works outweighing your bad works. No, salvation is through the Lord Jesus. Stay with me. Maybe you're here this morning and you have some education about you. And you're a little, maybe you have a little problem with believing in God and believing in the Bible. And that's why you haven't been saved yet. I want you to notice the second thing. I see a lesson, Chad, about the scripture. Amen. Would y'all look with me? Look back at verse 64. If you're there, say amen. Chapter 6. But there are some of you that believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not and who would betray him. I want you to know, number two, there's a lesson about the scripture. How many of y'all believe the scripture is the word of God? I want you to look at me. Look at me carefully. If you don't believe the Bible is the word of God, you can't be saved. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Somebody help me preach. Now, I'm going to do something this morning. Just if maybe you're here and you're a little skeptical about this Bible, I'm going to address you this morning. Maybe you're here and you've got some doubts even about God. I'm going to address you this morning. Maybe you're here and you just don't know for sure. I'm going to address you this morning. I tell you what I'm going to do. There's 330 prophecies about Jesus. Did you know that? 330 prophecies about Christ. Now, I want you to know something. Let me illustrate. Let's say that I'm going to tell you that it's going to rain today. You get me? Low probability. It's going to rain today, but it's going to rain at 10 o'clock and quit at 7. Then it's going to start back again at 8. Y'all with me? About the chances of that happening? Are y'all with me? Stay with me. Amen. Stay with me. I'm going to teach you something this morning. Let me give you just a look. I'm not trying to bore you, but I want you to just get how great the Bible is. If I don't finish all this passage, I want to finish this point above all points. I want to finish this. You know the probability of you getting struck by lightning is 7 to the 10th power, or in other words, 1 in 700,000. Being killed by lightning is 2 to the 10th, or the 6th power, or 1 in 2 million. Becoming president, which Chad, you will not, is 1 times the 10th power, or 1 in 10 million. A meteorite landing on your house is 1.8 times 10 to the 14th power, or that's 180 and 12 zeros. And the probability of you dying is 1 in 1. But hear me. Here's what I'm going to do. Will y'all just stay with me? You'll like this when I get done. Can I do this? I'm just going to take 8 prophecies. 8. Not my 330. 8. 8. Let me give them to you. Here's the prophecy I'm going to give to you. Christ was going to be born in Bethlehem, Micah 5:2. And the Bible says it was fulfilled in Matthew 2, 4 through 6. The probability of that is 2.8 times 10 to the fifth power, or 1 in 280,000. The forerunner of Christ, Malachi 3:1, John the Baptist. And I won't go into all the powers right now, but 1 in 1,000. Christ to be betrayed by a friend. Or excuse me, Christ riding in on a donkey. That's 1 in 100. Christ to be betrayed by a friend. And it's fulfilled in Luke 22, 21. 1 to the 10th and the third power, or 1 in 1,000. And that's Psalm 41 and verse 9. Christ be betrayed for 30 pieces of silver. Zechariah chapter 11 and 12. It was fulfilled in Matthew 26 and 15. That's 1 in 1,000. He betrayed for 30 pieces of silver and used it to buy a potter's field. That's fulfilled in Matthew 27, 3 through 10. That's 1 in 100,000. Y'all still with me? And although innocent, Christ kept saddled on trial. Isaiah 53, 7. That's 1 in 1,000. Christ crucified. Psalms 22, 16. Jesus was crucified. John 19. That's 1 in 10,000. Now, if you do, I'm going to do this and if you do all the math of every one of those eight probabilities, here's what you come up with the chance for it to happen. That's 1. Are y'all with me? Or excuse me, 10 and 28 zeros. Do you know what that is? You don't, do you? I'm looking at you. Me either. If anybody knows what 10 and 28 zeros is, Sister Audrey, your mom's a math teacher. You never learned that. How many of you never heard of a number like that? Come on now. You can't fathom that. Yet just eight, and by the way, every one of them was fulfilled to the letter by Jesus Christ. So what am I saying this morning? I'm saying that this Bible, this King James Bible, this preserved Word of God, somebody help me preach, it is true. Listen to me, if you die and go to hell, you'll go to hell by rejecting the Bible, which is true. The Bible says you're a sinner. The Bible says you're lost. The Bible said that Jesus died for you. The Bible said he arose from the grave. The Bible said that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you die and go to hell, it's because you went past the truth. Amen. Somebody help me there a little bit. By the way, not only is it true, it's been tried. How many of you agree it's passed the test of time? It's been trusted. There's some of you going through storms this morning. Hey, listen to me. I can't fix your problems this morning. I can't handle your problems this morning. But I want you to know there is a Bible that you can kiss this morning. There is a Word of God that you can trust this morning that says he'll never leave you nor forsake you. He'll go all the way with you. You got a God who is faithful. Well, somebody help me. Good preacher. And by the way, when the whole world's on fire, heaven and earth shall pass away. He said, my word shall not pass away. You said, what assures you you know you're going to heaven? Why in the world would you ever think you're going to heaven? I don't think I'm going to heaven. I know I'm going to heaven because everything that I am, I trust that Bible. Hold a minute. You say, has he ever, the devil ever come up to you and say, you're not saved. You don't act like a Christian. Hello? He starts reminding me of my past. You know what I do to him? I reminded him of his future. I'm going to tell him, devil, I'm going to heaven because I place my faith in the Word of God. I've never seen Jesus. I've never touched Jesus. I've never felt Jesus. But I want you to know he's real in my life this morning. I have been redeemed. I have been washed in the blood. I am saved. I'm sealed to the day of redemption. I know I'm going to heaven, but do you? I got some more. Can I give you a little more? A I can't hardly get off of that one. Number three, I really want to get this across to you. This may help some of you that struggle with this. If you don't struggle with it, let me struggle for you. There's a lesson about service here too. Look in verse 67. I want you to see this. I believe that Judas went away, but not only did he go away, a lot of people went away with him. By the way, when you fall away, most likely you're going to take somebody with you. Somebody sent me. Look what Jesus said. Then in verse 67. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will you also go away? Then Simon Peter answered and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And we believe and are sure that thou art the Christ. Woo! The Son of the living God. There's a lesson here about service. Now look at me, and I'm gonna slow down this tad. A lot of people won't serve God, and a lot of people don't want to be saved. And here's the excuse they live. Too many hypocrites. Preacher, I get saved, but they too many hypocrites. Come on now. I am not going to tell you there's not a Judas comes to Taze Valley. I'm not going to call their name. I don't know who it would be. But the world's full of hypocrites. But I want to ask you something. Are you going to serve God or get your eyes on some hypocrite? Or somebody, let's see, don't even call them a hypocrite. Let's just call them somebody that is not very sincere. Maybe you think somebody puts on a show a little bit. Come on now. Hey, there's some preachers that's worldwide and famous that put on a show. All they know is a show. They can tell the right story. But hold a minute. You what the Galatian writer said? If they preach in pretense the gospel, I glory in the gospel. I'm not going to tell you there's not people that put on a show. I'm not going to tell you there's people not very sincere. But should that keep you from serving God? Could that keep you out of the choir? Would that keep you out of being a Sunday school preacher? Because that one preacher, Judas, would that keep you from being called to preach? It should not this morning. Because where can we go? Because he has the words of eternal life. Let me give you a fourth thing. Y'all still with me? I'm just trying to pray. Man, I'm having a good time, Chad. There's a lesson here also about the social gospel. Because if you go back in, look, would you go back a little bit in chapter 6, just a little bit? There's a lot of churches today, I'm not going to lie to you. They only exist for one thing, social. I know two churches right within 3 miles of here has liquor in the basement. Liquor in the basement, wine in the basement. And somebody come to my church from a church in Charleston, I won't say where or who. They said they had raised there for a long time, but they had to leave because they went too far when they started having wine parties at Sunday school class. I want you to know if the church is all it is a social organization, people are going to die and go to hell. Now, I want you to know something. Here's what we teach here. Look at verse 26. Jesus answered them and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles. That's when he fed the 5,000. But because you did eat of the loaves and were filled. Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for the meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him hath God the Father sealed. And by the way, he said, I am that bread. The Catholics have this so far, and I'm going to say it, I'll probably get some hate mail, but I am going to say this. They are so messed up about this passage. Because he later says, he that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood. Come on. You got to do that to be saved. There's one organization that every Sunday morning at Mass, they take communion. They confess their sins to the priest and take communion. Boy, is it quiet in here now. And here's what happens. Here's what happens in their church. They believe in transubstantiation. What they believe is that bread and that fruit of the vine or their wine turns literally into the blood and the body of Christ. And they eat it every week to sustain. Never had a personal relationship with God. Boy, it's quiet in here now. Amen. I want to tell you, it's more than sacraments this morning. It's more than religion this morning. I want you to know, I'm introducing you to something this morning that's bigger than a religion. It's Christ. Amen. Now, we do social things. We got a food pantry due once a month. But I want you to know, ask Miss Angie. She's one of the leaders. I tell you what she does. They make sure they give the gospel every time. We have a frontline addiction group that we feed. Oh yeah, we feed them every week. There's some of them had to have a good meal all week. But I'll tell you, before they leave there, Brother Tyler, make sure they get the gospel. Amen. Lastly, am I preaching? But here's the biggie. There is also a lesson about sin. You know, I get accused of a lot of things. And I know why. I get accused of yelling at people. That's what somebody told me this week. Somebody went to church here 100 years ago that wasn't, they left over other pastors. They don't even know me. I'm not yelling right now. But sin will take you farther than you want to go and keep you longer than you want to stay. There's a great lesson about sin in Judas. Am I preaching? There are a lot of theories about him. One theory is that Judas, he kissed Jesus. He was trying to force Jesus' hand, thinking he wasn't manly enough. But when they come to get him, guess what happened to him? If you read all the Gospels, they fell backwards, right on the rear. Another theory about Jesus or Judas was that he was trying to participate in a crisis so Jesus would assert himself and establish his kingdom right then. Another theory about Jesus was, or Judas was, because of greed or 30 pieces of silver, he betrayed the Lord. I kind of lean on that. And then a fourth theory was that he was demon-possessed. And by the way, I want to say this to you. In one aspect, you are if you're lost. Here's what the Bible said. I'm not saying you're demon-possessed like those Gadareans, but what I am saying is, if you're not a child of God, you're a child of the devil. Ye are of your father, the devil. And how many of you agree with me? Sin deceives. There's some of you in this room right now want to be saved, like to be saved, thinking about being saved, but here's what's happened to you. Even right as I get ready to give the invitation, the devil's trying to tell you, well, later, the devil's trying to tell you, well, I'm not sure of all that yet, and the devil's trying to put you up, put it off, and sin deceives. The hell's full of people that the devil's deceived. Sin destroys. Most everybody in here, except a few folks I've seen before, and you new folks, thank God you're here this morning. But sin destroys. And sin will damn you into hell. And here's what it says about Judas. And both things are right. Now you listen carefully. Somebody asked me, did Judas repent? Here's what he done. He repented of himself. He didn't repent to God. That's what I call worldly sorrow. Oh, a whole lot of folk get worldly sorrow real quick. He repented of himself. Threw down the 30 pieces of silver. went up on a hill, got a rope, hung it to the tree, and hung himself. But that's not all the prophecy. Now, I'm going to tell you what the Romans would do. They, when someone hung themselves, they let the birds eat the flesh off of them. But the Bible said not only did he hang himself, but his whole bowels were burst open. You don't do that by hanging yourself, but what the Romans would do, they would cut the tree limb off and the body would fall down. In his case, it fell down into a rocky cliff and busted him wide open. And you know what's sad? Sin will destroy your life this morning, will burst you wide open, and you'll end up in hell without God. And if you're a Christian, sin will make you ineffective and useless for the work of God. Bow your head with me. I'm finished. I want to ask this real solemn question. If you were to die today, how many of you are 100% sure you'd go to heaven? Raise your hand if you die today. Just slip them high. Slip them high. Hold them up high. Thank you. I look across. There's a big crowd for a summer. There's some of you couldn't raise your hand. You know what? The devil wants to deceive you and get you lost forever. But Christ died for you. I wonder how many right now say, "Preacher, I couldn't raise my hand," but I want to tell you what, I want to be saved. I really do believe that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again. I want to be saved. I want to know I'm going to heaven before I die, before the Lord comes. Raise your hand up and just let me pray for you. I won't embarrass you. I won't point you out. I just pray. God bless that hand. Somebody else? "Preacher, I'm not saved, couldn't raise my hand, but dear God, I don't want to end up like Judas. I don't want to end up in hell. I don't want to end up... Boy, I've been in church. I've been hearing you preach a lot. And I don't want to die and go to hell. Preacher, pray for me." Raise your hand. I see that hand. Somebody else. How many Christians in this room? You're saved, but you've got your eyes on people. And you've let people keep you from serving God like you used to. You've got your eyes on some people that are not maybe sincere. I don't know. I'm not going to judge them. How many Christians in this room got your eyes on some hypocrite that's bothered you from serving God, and this morning you couldn't decide, "I want to serve Jesus"? Raise your hand. Yeah, I see it. I see it. I see it. I know what you're talking about. I've been there. Somebody else. "Preacher, I've got my eyes on some folks, and it's messing me up, but I need to get my eyes on Jesus." How many others? I'll tell you what I'd like for you to do. Come around the altar and pray. Stand with me. If you're not saved, dear God, come up here and let me take a Bible. I'll lead you to Christ. Sing for us.
"Come every soul,
why don't you meet me here?
My sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord."
Come up here. You want to be saved? Come up here and join us. I'll take a Bible myself. Show you how to be saved.
By trusting in His word,
amen.
Only trust Him. Only trust Him.
Yes.
Only trust Him now.
Amen.
He will save you.
Yes.
He will save.
Get your eyes on people. It'll mess your life up.
Plunge now,
amen,
into the crimson flood that washes white as snow.
Oh, yes.
Only trust Him. Only trust Him. Only trust Him. Savior.
Folks are praying. Would you be seated for a moment?
Savior.
God bless y'all. Bless you.